Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining today's session. My name is Irina, and I'm the event planner for the Redmond Reactor Space. Before we get started, I do have a few things to go over. Please take a moment to read our code of conduct. We seek to provide a respectful environment for both our audience as well as our presenter. We encourage engagement in the chat, but please be mindful of your commentary, remain professional and on topic. Useful links will also be shared in the chat. The session is recorded and will be available on demand in 24 to 48 hours on the Microsoft Reactor YouTube channel. Which brings us to today's session. The session will run approximately 1 hour with questions throughout, and I'll now turn it over to our speaker for introductions.
Hello there. My name is Steve Lorello. For those of you who don't know me, and I'm not sure who's watching, I am the .NET developer advocate at Redis, and today I'm going to be talking to you all about indexing, searching, and aggregations with Redis using Redis Search. And since I'm the .NET developer advocate, I'm going to be using .NET as well. So before I give any talk, I usually like to give just a brief introduction or a brief overview of what I'm going to be going over in the talk. We're going to start out by just doing a brief introduction of what Redis is. Many people watching this are probably familiar with Redis, but we're going to go over it again, just in case you've never heard of it before. You know, like, what's Redis? I don't know what that is. Then we're going to go and look at some of the data structures within Redis. And we're going to be looking at those data structures because they can become highly relevant for us when we're talking about the actual topic of this talk, which is indexing and searching for things in Redis. And then we're going to be talking about secondary indexes and specifically building secondary indexes with Redis. And there's really two different means you can go about building these secondary indexes with Redis. You can do this with any form of Redis, like any OSS version of Redis, and you can use Redis Search. And it's gonna become pretty obvious when we get to that part of the talk why Redis Search is so much nicer to use than building secondary indexes with Redis or with just any form of Redis. And then after that, after we go through building those secondary indexes with Redis and Redis Search, we're going to be looking at writing queries for Redis and then writing aggregations for Redis as well. Aggregations are a different topic that Redis Search, different topic and a different problem area that Redis Search allows us to tackle pretty effectively. So, what is Redis? Well, Redis is a NoSQL database. It's completely in memory, so everything that you commit to Redis is available on memory all the time. That's not to say that you can't store stuff that's in Redis on disk. There's different ways of doing that, so you can persist your data, but fundamentally anything that you add to Redis is available in memory all the time. Like at the end of the day, what Redis is just a key value store. So you have a key and values, and those values are different data structures, but essentially use a key to access a value. It's pretty simple. And this in Redis is this multimodal database. So what that means is there's different data structures. So even though it's a key value store, you have different data structures that are stored at those keys. And because it's completely in memory and because it's a key value store, it's really fast. I mean, blazingly fast. We usually measure execution time of operations in Redis in microseconds, as opposed to like milliseconds. And it's also pretty simple to use, which is these last two things are what really drew me to Redis and why I really like Redis and am really excited to work at Redis. So because it's simple and fast, it's extremely popular. So Redis data structures. There are a lot of data structures in Redis. I think there's a couple dozen or so different data structures that you can access using different modules and things within Redis. But the five that we have to talk about when we're going over the subject are strings, sets, sorted sets, hashes, and JSON. So strings are a single key. So like foo retrieves a single value in Redis, like bar. So that value, though, can be can basically be encoded as a numeric or a string. It could also be encoded as a bit field. But this is really the most basic data type that exists in Redis. And most users who use Redis, and anybody who's out there who's watching this that's familiar with Redis, are probably just familiar with this data type and really never got beyond it. The reason for that is because Redis's primary use is as a cache, and when you're using it as a cache, you oftentimes really just have like some key that you're looking up and you just hand it to Redis and it gives you back something. So like the typical example of using Redis or strings within Redis would be like setting foo to bar and then getting foo. So if I open up WSL and zoom in because people probably can't see it, and I started Redis. So I'm just going to do a Docker run. And I'm going to spin up a version of Redis. The one I'm going to use is the one I'm going to use later, and that's Redis/Redis stack. And if I open up Redis by popping into the CLI here, I can do things like I can set a foo to bar, and I can get foo. I could del foo, and I can say like set foo bar x5. And if I get foo, it's still there, but then if I wait a couple of seconds and try to get it again, it's going to expire eventually. So you can do all these neat little things with strings. So set foo bar, and then you can do like an append foo baz and get foo now returns bar baz. So the point is like this kind of shows you like what Redis is. It's this command driven data structure based database. So I'll clear this out. I'll flush the database and then it. So moving on from strings. So strings are the most basic type. Sets are another data structure within Redis. They're think mathematical sets. They're mathematical sets of unordered strings that live in Redis. And you can do these different set operations with them. So for anybody who took like discrete structures or something like that, in university or just familiar with mathematical sets, you can combine different sets together to produce these products that have intersections, which are like all the members in the two sets of the same difference, which are all the members of the first set that are not in the second set, and unions, which are all the members of the two sets. So if I go back to the terminal and I open up the Redis CLI again, I can say like sad, which is the command to sad, to add a member to a set. And I can say my set foo bar baz. I can then do an s members of my set, and it'll show me all the members in my set. If I had another set, let's call it my set two, foo bar, I can now run these operations on them. So like members my set two brings back foo and bar. But what if I wanted to find all of the members that in my set that are also in my set two? I can do a s inter, and I could say my set in my set two, and that brings back just that. If I do an s diff between the two, because foo and bar are in here but baz isn't, it is just return baz. And S union is just going to produce my set, because my set is a superset of my set two. But these become really useful, and they will become very useful later when we're actually looking at how to build secondary indexes with Redis, and in particular, any version of Redis. Open the slideshow again. Another type of set that also exists in Redis is called a sorted set. A sorted set is another type of set. Again, the like any mathematical set, there's no duplication allowed. That's something I guess I didn't mention before. So if I go back over here, I do a sad my set foo and bar, you see that it returns a zero here because it wasn't added. And if I do it as members of my set, as members of my set, you'll see that it still only has those three in there. And the reason for that is that's what sets are. They're unordered sets of strings that don't allow any duplication. So a sorted set is just like a set, except in addition to having the actual member string, it also has a score that's associated with that member. So again, it doesn't allow duplication, and you have these scores that you can use to order the set. And you can actually order and do ranges on the set using either that score, or if they're all set to zero, you can go lexicographically over the members of the set. So the example I'm using here is you have a person, people in your index, and you want to have, you want to be able to look up their ages. So you have a set called person colon age, and an ID, which would be the ID of the person is stored at, and the score, which is their age. So if I go back in here, I can do a zadd person colon age, and I'll say that person colon one is 33 and person colon two is 35. Now, if I wanted to find all the people that are less than 35, I'm going to do z range person colon age, and I can do a 0 to 34. Yeah, 0 to 34 by score. And that'll just bring back person one. But if I went up to 35, I think it's inclusive. Yeah, if I go up to 35, it brings back both people. Right? So these become really helpful when you're doing like numeric queries, and we'll go over that in a bit. Now, Redis hashes are like where we actually get into storing more complicated object-like data in Redis. So hash is just like a dictionary or a hash map or whatever the data structure you're familiar with using, but they're basically a dictionary, and they're a dictionary of strings, and you have fields and values within that strings. So you can basically set up that person object that we were talking about before. So if I go back in here, I can do an H set person colon one, and I can say that their first name is Steve and their age is 33. And likewise for person colon two, let's say that their first name is Bob and their age is 35. And I can get all the members from this set, or from this hash map, not each members, each get all, person colon one. And that brings back all the fields and values that are within that hash. Or if I just want to get one, I could just do each get person colon one, age, and I can just pull back the age. So, and the last data type that we want to talk about here is JSON. And JSON is sort of like, it sort of serves a similar functionality to a hash, in that it allows you to store these richer, more complicated objects in Redis. But instead of storing them as a hash, you can now store them basically almost like blobs of JSON. But instead of storing them as blobs of JSON, you're basically storing it as this nicely indexed version of JSON. But from your perspective, all you have to do is drop the JSON into Redis, and you can store these richer objects. You can access anything in it by their JSON path. You can update them by their JSON path. And the trick with JSON is that, unlike a hash or the other data types we talked about so far, they're not available in the default open source. Anybody can just pull it and use it. From any version of Redis that's out there. They're actually available in a module, and a module is a extension of Redis. Redis has this API for allowing module builders to come in and build extensions to Redis. So you can use it with this module, and it's available under the source available license. But since we're using the Redis stack Docker image right now, and Redis stack is something that you can use to run a bunch of modules and your basic OSS version of Redis at the same time, we can use Redis JSON right now. Now, this is all available under a source available license. I'm not a legal expert, but basically what that means is that as long as you're not selling this as a database product, you can use it for free in your application. But if you want to basically get it through a cloud provider, you have to use Redis Enterprise or Redis Cloud. I think it's coming to Acre, which is the Azure Cache or Redis Enterprise. But for the but that's basically the stipulation. But if you want to use it on your own, you can use it for free. And all the modules I'm going to talk about in this talk are available under the same license. So to demonstrate what this does, I can say like json.set person:1 again. So in Redis, we have this this convention of namespacing with a colon. So person is the namespace and colon, one is the ID. And I can pass in my JSON path, which in this case is just gonna be the dollar sign. That's the root, or that's the from where you're changing the JSON, basically that JSON path. And then I can pass in my JSON string, which would be like first name again, and call it Steve, and age, and set that to 32. And now I can just get things from within here by just accessing it via the JSON path. If I wanted to, well, I'm actually not 32 anymore, so I can do a JSON.set. And now that this has actually been created already, all I need to do is go in person:1, age, and set it to 33, and that'll update it. I go back into here, I get 33, and I can just get the whole object out by accessing the root path. And it basically pulls back this nice little JSON string for me. You know, I'm clicking on the share in StreamYard, I'm not clicking on my terminal, whoops. Okay, so why did we go over all these data structures? Well, the reason we did this is because these become really important when we're talking about finding stuff in Redis, which is really the topic of this talk. So finding stuff in Redis. Well, unlike a SQL database or another database that allows you to just scan over what's in it, Redis doesn't allow you to just build queries sort of willy-nilly that allow you to access data by their value. So like select star from people where first name is equal to Steve and select star from people where age is less than 35 just isn't going to work in Redis unless you build a secondary index on top of it. And sort of secondary indexing is sort of what lies at the heart of this talk. So what are secondary indexes? They're just a way to efficiently find things on the primary index. In Redis, the primary index are the keys. It's a key value store. So the primary index that we use is a key. And the trick with a secondary index is that they need to be explicitly declared and they need to be separately maintained and updated throughout the life cycle of Redis. So a secondary index in vanilla Redis involves a real conglomeration of the data structures that we've talked about so far, maybe with the exception of strings. But the data structures that we've talked about so far, sets, sorted sets, and hashes, those three big ones from just your vanilla version of Redis, become really important when we're talking about searching for things in Redis. Basically, you can set up your sets so that you can do things like exact matches of text, exact matches in numbers. You can sort by numbers. And there's even ways of doing full text search based off of just the basic data structures in Redis. And that last one is a real pain. I actually don't even know how to do that, but I'm gonna go over the first three. So for example, you might have these indexes that I've alluded to so far, like person:age might be the index of the age attribute within a hash. And then you might have like a set, like person:name:Steve that contains all the people named Steve, right? And what that does, what that allows you to do is it allows you to build that exact match or that numeric match. So an exact match with any version, any vanilla version of Redis, you're going to take all of your data and you're going to store it in hash. Then you're going to basically go through every field that you want to index, and then you have to create a set for that field. And then you can query that set in that set's name. So we basically use the name of the set as our index. And that set's name is whatever the index name is, so person, for example, colon, whatever the field is. So first name, for example. Drew's drinking a lot of water today. Sorry, my throat's bothering me. Colon value, and whatever that value is. And then you can query the set for that index name, field, and value. And then you can query all the hashes that come back from the result. And if you want to run any more complicated queries, you have to use those set combination operators that we looked at before. So let's take a look at this real quick. And it's going to become obvious why this is such a pain. So I flush a database, I can clear it. So I'll do hset person colon one, first name, Steve. Last name is Lorello, age is 33. I'll do the same thing for person colon two, first name, Bob. Last name, I'll just call him Smith. Age is 35. Now, to add Steve, to add these two people to that the name index, I have to say s add person colon first name colon Steve to, and I have to add person colon one. And for Bob, I add that person colon two. For last name, I do the same thing, but I have to change the name of the set. Smith and Lorello. And then for age, it's actually a little, we won't do age for now. We'll do that next. And then to query them, so if I want to find all the people named Steve, I have to do it S members. Person colon first name colon Steve, and that brings back all the Steves, and then I can do each get all person colon one, and that's creating the index, searching it, and querying the stuff from it. So I have to do all these successive operations. If I want to find all the people named Steve Lorello, I have to do it S enter person colon first name colon Steve person colon first name colon Lorello, and I don't, or not first name, colon last name, and that brings back the person that I want. So like, I can construct these secondary indexes and I can query them. I can build these more complicated queries using the set operations, which is, I mean, a nice thing, right? It's nice to be able to do that. But so that's that. What happens when you want to do like a numeric range query or like even a numeric exact match query, right? Well, we can do that with a sorted set for the particular field name. So in our person example here, how old is Steve? So Steve is, sorry, my dog just came to the party. Is everything okay, honey? She's defending the house. Her name is Honey. That's why I called her that, like H-O-N-E-Y. She's very nice, but she a little bit attached to me. Anyway, so Steve is 33, so I could do person colon age. I would do Z add person colon age, and then 33 person colon one. And then for Bob, who's 35, I would do 35 in person colon two. And then if I want to find all the people who are less than 35, which is our second query there, I would do a Z range person colon age 0 to 34. Oh, that's by rank, by score. That brings back person colon 1. And then I can query all those people that are that have the age of less than 35. Oh, that's kind of a lot. Now, what are the pros and cons of the strategy of indexing? The big pro is that you can do this with any form of any Redis database that's out there. Like, these data structures are available anywhere. You can use them. You can just like pick them up off the shelf and use them. It also allows you to have total control over what you index and what you don't. And I somewhat facetiously say that it is excellent for job security, because this is a really complicated way of building your indexes. You saw me do it, and I did it for really very trivial examples of building these indexes. But as you add more fields to your index, building and maintaining your index becomes very complicated. And actually, really the biggest con is that it's impossible to horizontally scale the database and maintain any type of atomicity when you're updating data. Why is this? Well, when it comes to Redis, when you want to horizontally scale your database out, you create new shards of Redis. So you basically horizontally scale the key space of Redis out across multiple shards. Now, the trick is that if any two keys in like a transaction or script that you want to run exist on different shards, you can't do it, because all the keys for any single Redis command that runs need to be on the same shard. So you can't like say, oh, person colon one is on shard one, but the age index is on shard two. All right, let me query, get all the people whose age is 32, and then query them, and then return them all back to the user in one shot. It's impossible. And that actually becomes even harder when you try to update. So what if I updated my age from 32 to 33? And I would have to go in and I would have to change it in the hash where the person is, and then I would have to also go over to the index and change it in the index. And those two aren't in the same shard, so they can't happen at the same time. So basically, you need to go through and regularly check your cluster for consistency and regularly update things to keep them consistent, which is a real headache. And that's actually why we have Redis Search. And Redis Search is a module of Redis, that another module like the Redis JSON, which is maintained by Redis. And it allows you to define the schema of an index, and then Redis will just take care of indexing everything for you. And it automatically indexes all of your data for you, and it does it across shards. So we have something called the RS coordinator, which allows you to update your object, and then it'll coordinate across the shards to basically make sure that everything is maintained the same. Everything's maintained in the same place, because your index is maintained on the same shard as your your inverted index for all of your Redis search stuff is maintained in the same shard that the objects live on. And then when you're querying things, they go across the shards to get everything. Now, this also provides other things like full text search capabilities, which, like I said, is difficult to do sort of out of the box with Redis. And also provides geo filtering capabilities. And it allows you, to index automatically across shards. And it's available under that same source available license. So this part I already did. You could spin up an instance of Redis stack, and that has both search and JSON on it. Creating indexes is pretty straightforward, but there's one type that you can't see in here. But there's different, there's four different index types. There's tags, text, numerics, and geos. Tags are great for exact matches. Text is great for full text searches. Numerics are for ranges or exact matches. Exact matches on numerics, and geo is a geographic search. So like if you have like a particular spot that you want to draw a circle around and find it, then that's your best bet there. Querying is done using this special query syntax that RediSearch has for tag fields. It looks like, it sort of looks like this. You have the, basically use the at symbol for indicating a field name. So at field name colon, and then in braces, you put whatever your search data is. For text fields, it's the same thing, but without the braces. For geofields, you can, there's a special geofiltering syntax you can use too, but I like to use the geofilter subcommand within Redis, RediSearch. And you just do a geofilter, you pass in the field name, and you pass in the longitude, latitude, radius, and unit. For numerics, you would just use at field name, colon, for, and then in square brackets, the lower bound and the upper bound. And those are, that's basically how you query different things. Right. So there's more to it, but that's the basics of it. And I think in the chat, they already shared the resources for actually looking at the query language in RediSearch docs. Now, aggregations are also really interesting. It allows you to query data and alongside in the same syntax that you would query your data normally using a RediSearch query. But it also allows you to build pipelines to transform the index data in Redis. And you can group things together and run reductions on them. You can also run apply functions against the data in your index that you return back from your query. And then you can filter based off of things previously executed in the pipeline. So apply functions basically allow you to execute functions against your data. So for example, if you had sales in the sales adjustment, you might be able to multiply sales by sales adjustment to get adjusted sales. Because those two things might vary, but the product of them might be something that's relevant for your application. And these apply functions allow you to have a variety of mathematical string and timestamp functions that you can apply to your data in the pipeline. And I'll show you all this in a little bit in some code. And then it allows you to store the results of your apply functions in the pipeline and then use them further down the pipeline. Group bys and reductions. So group bys allow you to group like things together. And the reductions are things that you could run on things that you've grouped together. So you can compute things like sums and averages and standard deviations. And then those group records can also be used further down the pipeline. And that brings us to Redis Ohm, which is a library that's near and dear to my heart because I'm the builder and maintainer of it. In Redis Ohm, basically, there's four versions of it. I only wrote the .NET version. But the .NET version in particular provides a declarative syntax for index creation. And it provides a fluent API for searching and aggregation in Redis Search. And it also provides object mapping and mapping objects to the two primary data structures I referred to earlier, which are hashes and JSON. So with that, I'm going to pop off here and I'm going to start a new little project. So I'll go into CD projects, Redis, I'll do .NET new console-n, test Redis Ohm, and I'll CD into test Redis Ohm. And here, to install Redis Ohm, all I have to do is do .NET add package redis.ohm. And I'll open this up in Rider when it chooses to open. And now, the nice thing about Redis Ohm is that it allows you to just basically declare your objects, create the index based off of those declarations, and then you can query things within Redis with those declarations. So open the Explorer again. So the example I always like to use is Muppets. So I will add a new class that will call it Muppet. And in Muppet, the first thing I need to do is that declare that this class is a document that we want to store at Redis. I'm going to set the storage type for it to be, let's do JSON. And so with that, I can actually just start off and get cracking by just adding whatever fields I want to it. I'll give them first names, last names, give them age. I'll give them another string. Give them an opportunity to say their piece. They'll call this a personal statement. Then I'll do a geolock called home location. Now I've built this Muppet class now. So if I wanted to go into my program file to initialize Redis OM, all I have to do is create a Redis connection provider. So var provider, I'll zoom in so people can see. Provider equals new Redis connection provider. And I just have to pass in a URI. So Redis :// localhost :637639. And then I can just pull this Muppets collection out of here. So var Muppets equals provider dot Redis collection Muppet. Now, I did cheat a little bit. I have a few Muppets that I always like to use in this example. So I spelled home location right in here. I didn't. There you go. That's spelled correctly. So I have Kermit, Beaker, and Bunsen. They're the three favorites that I like to use when I use the Muppets in my examples. And now with those Muppets created, well, the last thing I'm going to do every time, and this is not something I think I would suggest people usually do, is I'm going to go ahead and flush a database before anything else happens. So provider.connection.execute async flush db. That's just to give me a clean slate every time that when I'm starting. So if I have this collection here, I can now do things like I can add a Muppet to my Redis instance. So Muppets.insert, let's say Kermit. Our ID equals Muppets.insert, it's really key. And now with Kermit inserted, I can actually pull Kermit out of Redis by saying, are also Kermit equals Muppets dot find by ID Kermit. Okay. Now if I wanted to go in, I can say console dot write line. Also Kermit dot first name. Also Kermit dot last name. Now when I print this all out, dot net run, you'll see that Kermit the Frog comes out. Now that's not really that super interesting, right? All right, great. You can insert Kermit into Redis and you can get him out by his key name. But what if I wanted to find Kermit by his first name? Well, if I go back into Muppets, I can now basically add these attributes to them called, there's two, there's index and searchable. And I'll add index to everything except personal statement. I'll make a personal statement searchable. And with that all done, I've now declared this as something that I can create an index for. So if I go back into my program file, I can take this provider and I can say provider.connection.createIndex. And I can pass in Muppet. And this will actually create a Muppet index for me. And then that's all I have to do to declare this index and have it actually index all these documents that I'm inserting into it. So let me also insert speak your inbox into. So they're not forgotten about. And if I want to find all of the Muppets named Kermit, I can say, I can take that Muppets collection and I can say Muppets.where x.firstname equals Kermit. And this now will actually query all the Muppets in my database called Kermit, and it'll print them all out. And you see that it printed out Kermit the Frog again. What if I wanted to find all the Muppets whose first name is Beaker, for example? Same deal. That's all I got to do. Now I'll print out Kermit and Beaker. What if I want to find the Beaker with that, or Bunsen, with the last name? Let me do. I just say and x dot last name equals. Let me do. That's all I have to do. I could basically use LINQ to create these queries now. So just a nice familiar. It's a nice familiar language for .NET developers to use for querying things in Redis now. And this is something that you've never been able to do before. So this really gets kind of nice. If I want to find all the Muppets, so I'll just do a little lines of demarcation here. So console.writeLine Muppets whose first name is Bunsen and last name is Honeydew. Let me just find now all the Muppets who are less than 65. You can do the same thing. I mean, as you probably guessed, all I have to do is go in and take the age. And say age is less than 65. And if I recall, I think the only one who's 65 or older is Kermit, who is 66. And that's based off of when they appeared on the Muppets. I don't think it's not actually a proper age. Now, in this model, I also added this personal statement field. So Kermit is a frog guitarist. Beakers is that I am a humble lab assistant and scientist. And Bunsen is I am a scientist and inventor. So what Redis OHM and Redis Search allow you to do also is build these full text search queries. And with Redis Search, all you have to do is take the field that you've marked as searchable. So in Muppet, we declared personal statement as searchable, right? All I have to do now is take that personal statement and run a query against it to extract the Muppets who meet a certain text matching criteria. So I'll find all the Muppets who are scientists. And to do that, all I have to do is say x dot personal statement equals scientist. And that'll also print out Beaker and Bunsen, because Beaker and Bunsen both said that they were scientists in our personal statement. What if I wanted to find all of the Muppets, or what if all the Muppets want to go out to dinner and they want to find a nice place to eat? And they wanted to look at, what's relatively close to us? Well, like I found just a random restaurant in LA, Snowboo's. And I figured that, I think they film the Muppets out in Hollywood. So I figured that would make sense. So let's see if we could find all the Muppets that are within 10 miles of Snowboo's. So Muppets within 10 miles of Nobu's. I could do Muppets dot, but instead of where, I could do Muppets dot geofilter. And I could take their home location. So the home location is a geolock, which is a special data structure for Redisome. And I can say nobu.lat, nobu.long. And then 10 miles. Use this geolock distance unit miles. Then I can just print out all the Muppets that meet that criteria. Which is none of them, so that's not quite right. I did something wrong. Oh, that's what I did wrong. It's longitude, latitude. That is an interesting quirk of Redis, that we do everything in longitude and latitudes. I'm told that that's what the Italians do, and the author of Redis, Salvatore, is Italian, so that's our excuse for it. But that's one of those funky things that you learn when you work for Redis. So we do everything long lat instead of lat long. So all the Muppets are within 10 miles of Nobu's. Now, what if I want to tighten that filter and have it be 5 miles instead? All I had to do was drop that down to 5. And all the Muppets within 5 miles of Nobu's are just Beaker and Bunsen. So that's all the searching. That's a lot of the searching syntax. You can add other things too. So like if I had a address, right? And the address had a prop string, street num, street number, and like, well, I'll just do a zip code. I'll just have a zip code being here. That's the only thing I'm going to index. I can set mark that as indexed. And then I can add this address. In here, but the trick is I need to actually set a cascade depth to 1 for it to actually properly create this the index. And because it doesn't want it, you don't want it to traverse like endlessly into an object. So you set it to cascade depth of 1, and it'll just go into that address and find the one property that's in there, which is zip code, and just use all of that. Now, I then take, then we'll just go in and say like add a zip code to two, three, four, five. So Kermit will live it in 12345 zip code. I could then search all the Muppets. In 12345 zip code. Say x.address.zipcode equals 5. Gotta be a where clause. You'll see that it prints out Kermit the Frog, and it builds the index and allows you to query the index, you know, pretty easily. So moving on to aggregations, which is the last subject we'll talk about, and I'll just talk about it somewhat briefly. The aggregations are those things that I was talking about earlier. They allow you to build these pipelines of things that we want to operate on. So what does that mean? Well, what if I wanted to find the average age for all the Muppets? So I can say var Muppet aggregations equals provider dot aggregation set Muppet. And if I want to have something in, if I want to have something in my Muppet class be aggregatable, I need to go in and say that it's aggregatable. I'll set home location and age as aggregatable. And so when the index is created, it'll actually mark it as sortable, which allows it to be loaded immediately into the pipeline. So you don't have to do anything else. So with Muppet aggregations now, I can do a for each bar results in Muppet aggregations dot, or actually, no, I'm just finding the average age. So var average age equals Muppet aggregations dot average dot record shell age. Now, this record shell here is sort of important to understand what the meaning of that is. The record shell is like an is meant to be like an always null copy of an always null copy of the object class that allows you to access things within that class. So I want to just access the agent here. I don't actually, and this is on the Redis server. So like the records live on the Redis server and I'm just accessing the age from within those. So just keep that in mind. When you get a result back, now average age in this case is just a double, but when you get a result back from this, just bear in mind that the record shell is always going to be null. If I just do a console.writeline average age, I can see that the average age is, I should have no idea what the average age of these puppets is. The average age in this case is 51.3. You could also do other things like, so for example, if you want to just find the standard deviation, you just do instead of average, you just do the standard deviation. I didn't print it out. If I printed it out, it would actually print out that the standard deviation is 12.74 years. So, like, you can run these operations against. You can do these reductions against the data in Redis. Another thing that you can do, which is kind of cool with aggregations, is you can apply different functions to them. So if I wanted to, I could say, I could find what all the ages of the Muppets would be in like 3 years, right? For each, I would do a for each var result in Muppet aggregations dot apply. And I would say x dot record shell dot age plus 3. And I would call this something. I have to give it an alias for the result. And I'll say age in 3 years. Now I can do a console.writeline I could say result sub age in 3 years. And that'll print out what that age is going to be in 3 years. So that's Kermit, Beaker, and Bunsen. It just adds 3 to every record's age and provides that to you. But what this means is that you can apply these different mathematical, there's also string functions that you can do string formatting with it. And there's also even like functions that allow you to do like radiuses and like geolocation. So on your geolocation. So if I wanted to find what everyone's distance from a particular point was, I could say for each bar result in Muppet aggregations that apply. Apply functions dot geodistance, and I can find it by saying x dot record shell dot home location and the place that I want to go to. So no boost in this case. Now we just have to call this something. So distance from no boost. I can do the same thing. I could say console dot write line. And I can pull out that distance from Nobu's by saying Muppet's distance from Nobu's is result sub distance from Nobu's. And importantly, this is in meters. So about how many meters each of them is from Nobu's. So you'll see that Kermit is the furthest with 14,000 meters. He basically is from Nobu's. Yeah, so like, you know, that's pretty much all I have for today. Before I go, just a little bit more about me. Again, I'm Steve Lorello. I am a developer advocate at Redis, specifically on the .NET developer advocate. You can follow me at Twitter at slorello or on GitHub at github.com/slorello89. Here's some resources. I think that Reactor's already showed them into the chat, but these are basically all the resources for this. This presentation. If you have any questions about Redis or you want to learn more about it, we actually have our own little Redis University that's free for everyone to come in and use if you want to learn more about Redis. If you have any questions about Redis, the best place to place to ask them is in our Discord server, discord.gg/redis. I myself and my colleagues are on, you know, most weekdays pretty much all the time. So if you have any questions about Redis, you're more than welcome to stop by. So that's about it. That's about all I got.
Thank you. And thank you everyone for joining. We appreciate you taking the time out to visit. If you have any feedback, we'd love to hear what you have to say. I've added the survey on the screen as well as in the chat. For this specific event, it's 16457. In that survey, you can provide feedback on this specific session or any future sessions, any topics you'd like to hear. Thank you everyone. Until next time.